Let's grab our Bibles. Exodus chapter 14 is where we're going to be together. We are in a semester-long journey through the book of Exodus. And so far, the Israelites have seen God pour out miracles and pour out his wrath upon the Egyptians. And we get to one of the most famous passages that you find anywhere in the Bible. Today, the Israelites are going to cross the Red Sea. All right, this is one of the highlights of the entire book of Exodus. And today, I want to speak to you from the book of Exodus, chapter 14. And I want us to talk about your life today. And I also want us to talk about our church. And so really today, I want to prepare you. It's going to be a little bit of a different day, even in the way that I preach this message, because I do want to speak to you about you, and I want to speak to you about us, if that makes sense. And so I'm going to give you a little vision here for both campuses today. You know, as we think about the crossing of the Red Sea, there have been many across the years who have tried to explain away the miracle of the Israelites crossing the Red Sea. People have said things like, well, there was a giant sandbar through the Red Sea, and that's how the Israelites got through the Red Sea. And by the way, not only do people try to discount that miracle, but many miracles across the Bible, they try to discount because they are, what the Bible would say, they are supernatural. They are beyond the natural. And I would just tell you, let's agree with that. These things that we read in the Bible, like today's message, is beyond the natural. It is supernatural. And so I would just say it to you this way. If you can't handle God parting some waters and some people walking through on dry ground, what in the world are you going to do about the whole Son of God coming in the form of a baby, born of a virgin, dying on the cross for the sins of the world, rising again from the dead, and then coming back soon? That's a whole lot bigger of a faith jump than seeing God do what we see him do in this passage. We serve a miracle-working God. Isn't that true, church? And today we're going to see that on display. The title of our message today is It's Time to Cross Over. It's time to cross over. In your life and in this church here at Springdale and at Pinnacle Hills and even at Fayetteville, it is time to cross over into the new thing that God is doing. And we are not to be driven by fear or by caution, but we are to be driven by faith and by trust in the Lord. As you get into Exodus chapter 14, remember the people of Israel, some 2 million of them, have just left Egypt after the miracle of the 10 plagues that God sent. God has given Moses instructions for the Passover, for the Feast of Unleavened Bread. He has promised to guide them with the cloud by day, fire by night, and that's where we enter into this chapter here together. And if you think Pharaoh and the Egyptians are long gone and out of the story, you are wrong. There's going to be one last Hail Mary attempt for the people of Egypt and Pharaoh to come again and to try to bring the Israelites back into slavery. That's where we pick up the story. Look down at verse 10 of chapter 14. It says, when Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them. And they feared greatly. And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us in bringing us out of Egypt? Is not this what we said to you in Egypt? Leave us alone that we may serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. Not exactly the thank you that Moses was expecting, right? This is a vastly different scenario. Israel is completely freaking out. This is worst case scenario in their minds. In their minds, this whole thing has gone nuclear. And they truly believe that they're about to die. Moses has led them into a disaster. And Israel's response here says something about your heart, and it says something about my heart. In fact, the human heart will bend towards a couple things. Number one, it will bend towards us. Our hearts are bent towards forgetfulness. Nowhere in the text do we see anyone calling up and standing up and just one person saying, hey guys, do we remember what God has just done for us? Our hearts are bent towards forgetting what God has done. You know, I want to remind you, sometimes it just takes one person in a family to remind people of what God's done. Sometimes it just takes one person in a small group or even one person in an entire church to say, let's remember what it is that God has done. Israel has seen God move on their behalf unlike any country before or since that moment. 10 plagues devastated those who held them in slavery. They've been in slavery for some 430 years. And these people are devastated. Why? Because they have forgotten all of that. A lack of remembering what God has done in your life also leads you towards devastation. Do you realize that? That if you fail to remember what it is that God has done in your life, you also will find yourself in a place of forgetting and in a place of likewise a devastation. Here's the second thing, okay? Not only are our hearts bent towards forgetfulness, but our hearts are also bent towards fear. Israel goes worst case scenario in their minds. Anybody ever guilty of that in the room? I go worst case scenario. Okay, how about you at Pinnacle Hills? Anybody go, man, I often go worst case scenario in my mind. Had they remembered what God had delivered them from, perhaps they would have responded in faith instead of fear, but yet, again, they think that they are about to die. They say literally these words to Moses, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have led us here? Man, what little faith that really is. Here's the third thing. Our hearts are also bent towards the familiar. They're bent towards the familiar. The Israelites say these words, it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. In this moment, they were drawn back to the familiar, even though the familiar wasn't good. They were drawn back to the familiar, even though familiar, listen to this, even though familiar meant slavery. They would rather live in the familiar, even though it was horrible, than cross over into the new thing that God has for us. Everybody at both campuses, listen to me very carefully, okay? All of us are bent towards what is familiar and what is comfortable, even if it's not right for us. This explains why many of us go back to sin patterns in our life, amen, or we go back to unhealthy relationships in our life, and we get to the end of it and think, well, why did I do that again? Often we do it because it's familiar. And even here you see the Israelites as an example of our own hearts. Now, I gotta be honest with you, it's easy to look at the Israelites in this journey and to look down upon them, like kind of thumb our nose at them and say, I can't believe that you did that. And yet I wanna remind us that all of us have a heart that is exactly the same as theirs, that is often bent towards fear, that is often bent towards forgetfulness of what God has done, and it is bent towards the familiar, even when the familiar is not good. If you keep on reading, look at verse 13. It says, and Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you and you have only to be silent. I would underline verse 14 in your Bible if you have it there or your notebook. The Lord will fight for you and you have only to be silent. Moses says, don't be afraid, stand firm, watch what God is about to do. The Lord will fight for you. You have to only be quiet. Is that not an amazing thing for Moses to stand before the people? Imagine I'm Moses standing before the people of Israel and I'm like, listen guys, stop fearing, do not be afraid, just sit there and watch the Lord fight for you. By the way, you'll often find yourself in seasons where this verse applies to you, where the word of God for your life is to stop worrying, do not be afraid, stop trying to control the situation, stop trying to do all that you can do, and just stop, and the Lord will fight for you. Surely there's somebody here today at Springdale, somebody there in the room at Pinnacle Hills who that word is for you today. How does the Lord respond? Look at verse 15. The Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to do what? To go. Thank you for one person over here. Tell the people of Israel to go forward, okay? And the Bible here, as you keep on reading, the Bible says that, remember the cloud that was before the people? It moved to behind the people. And here's what happened. This is the moment of all moments in the book of Exodus. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night. and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided, and the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on what ground? On dry ground. And the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on to their left as well. And the Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea. All Pharaoh's horses, his chariots and his horsemen. And in the morning watch, the Lord, here he is, the Lord in the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down in the Egyptian forces and threw the Egyptian forces into a panic. Do you know that God can do things that you can't do? It's a great reminder here. Clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily, and the Egyptians, they're figuring out what's going on. They say this, let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians. Even the enemies of God recognize when God entered into the picture. Amen. And their word was, let's get out of here. Their God is fighting for them. The Bible goes on to tell us not one Egyptian lived, but they all died right there who were pursuing Israel. While Israel walked on dry ground, can we all just say miracle, miracle, miracle? Verse 30, the Bible says this, thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great power that the Lord had used against the Egyptians, so the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Think about this simple truth. Had the people of Israel not crossed over into the new thing that God was doing in their life, they would have missed out on a whole lot. Isn't that true? Had they not crossed over, they would have never seen the power and salvation of God like they did in that instance. Had Israel not crossed over, they might have returned to a life of slavery in Egypt. Had Israel not crossed over, I don't think it's a stretch to say that some of them surely would have died by the hand of the Egyptians. And everybody at both of these campuses, listen to me loud and clear. Sometimes you have to cross over to experience what it is that God wants for you in the future. You can't remain in the past. You can't remain in the familiar. But it's time to cross over in your life to the new thing that God is doing. By the way, it's time for us to cross over into the new thing that God is doing right here in our church at Springdale, Fayetteville, and there at Pinnacle Hills. I truly believe that God is calling you to some things through this passage, and I really believe that God is calling our church as well to some things. If you're a note taker, I want you to write these three things down. I'll roll through these very quickly, okay? Number one, it's time to cross over from forgetfulness to remembrance. Are you one who goes worst case scenario? Are you one who naturally bends towards fear? Well, the Bible is calling you to remember what it is that God has done for you. How has God moved in your life? How has God moved in this church? Let's be a people of remembrance here together. Secondly, it's time to cross over from fear to faith. We need to be people who are not worst case scenario people, but man, if God gets involved, then there is no limit kind of people. Like if God gets involved in my life, then there is no limit to what can happen. If God gets involved in this church, then there's no limit as to what can happen. Thirdly, it's time to cross over from the familiar to the new. This is where I want us to park for the rest of our time here this morning. In your life, if you only stick to the familiar, you will never move forward accordingly. And in your life, and in this church, if we only stick to the familiar, we will never move forward and experience what God wants us to experience. And so I just get up a blanket statement here. It's time for us to move forward. It's time for us to cross over into the future. And so today I want to speak to you specifically at Springdale campus today about something that we are starting right now, like literally right now as I speak. This kicks into high gear, okay? Now, those of you at Pinnacle Hills, if you're like, well, what about us, okay? I've not forgotten about you. In fact, as I shared with our staff what I was gonna share with the Springdale campus today, Chris Deitch, your campus pastor, said, Nick, we're headed in much of the same direction, so share it here as well. So I'll do this at this service. I will do the same also at the 11 a.m. when I drive up there here in just a moment. Let me speak to both campuses for a moment. Let me speak, first of all, to those of you at Pinnacle Hills, all right? You are about to move into the future in a new and a different way. You are about to have a brand new student building that will open sometime around the beginning of the fall, August, September-ish. And I was up there walking through it yesterday, and I am blown away with what's about to happen. So bottom floor, brand new student building. On the top floor, we will have space for really about 10 small groups per Sunday, if not even more than that, if you use a third hour. But an incredible space up there that will also double as our seminary space. So you, not only are you about to have a new student building, small group space like we've never had before at the Pinnacle Hills campus, but you're about to have a fully functioning seminary on your campus. And I just want to speak directly to all of you at Pinnacle Hills. Your life at Pinnacle Hills is about to change. Everything's going to change. I believe it's going to be good, but you need to recognize that things are about to change and it's time to cross over. So let's not fight the future, but let's cross over together. We are primed for the future at Pinnacle Hills. I hope you sense that today. I just want to let you know at that campus, you are running more in your average attendance than you ever have at the Pinnacle Hills campus. Isn't that a cool thing, Springdale? The Pinnacle Hills, amen. By the way, it was this congregation of people that believed in the future of the church at Pinnacle Hills. And so all these years later, Pinnacle is running more than it has ever run before, had just shy of 6,000 people on Easter Sunday. Just an incredible thing. So we praise God for that. Here's the cool thing. Okay, let's go. Come on. This 9:30 service is a simulcast service, so wherever I'm at, it either follows me here or at Fable Campus. Just to tell you kind of what's going on there, in the last few years, we have seen that service move from about 350 people in the room at the 9:30 service to last Sunday, they had over 1,000 people in the room, which is an incredible praise God, and we're so excited for you. So Pinnacle, everything's moving in the right direction. And it's time to cross over into the future, okay? Springdale Campus, can I talk to you for a moment here today? You are winning. I hope you realize that. I hope you sense and feel the fact that the Springdale Campus is winning. We are seeing God do incredible things in our midst right now. Our average attendance, it is at a place it has not been since 2009 and 2010. So praise God for that. Yeah, absolutely. I've told... A lot of people, as I just have conversations, the renovation of the worship center is happening at the exact right time because there's a wind of the Spirit of God blowing through the Springdale campus, and we are lifting the sail right now saying, Lord, we're trying to do what we can. You do what you can. And we're believing God for that. And here's what I would tell you. God has given us a once in a 20-year opportunity right now. Right now. We built the worship center in 1988. Some 25-ish years later, we renovated the worship center. Now here we are 22 years later. So a roughly once in a 20-year opportunity, God is giving us on a silver platter in a campus that is already moving in the right direction. And here's what I'd say. It's time for us to move forward together. God has us at the exact moment we are and at the exact moment we need to be for this hour. And so today, right now, we are starting something that we are calling Relaunch Springdale. You see, when we talk about relaunching Springdale, this is a process we're going to go through from now until the worship center opens. Hopefully sometime around mid to late August is our projected timeline. And so from now until then, we're in a process of relaunching the campus. Hear me loud and clear. This is much more than the renovation of one room on this campus. This is a relaunching of the entire ministry of the Springdale campus to the community where we're gonna go crazy. And we're gonna go crazy together in the best way possible, okay? Now, again, those of you at Pinnacle Hills, as I shared these things with Chris Deitch, he's like, Nick, share it with the Pinnacle people. That's where we're headed as well. So you say, well, Nick, what are we gonna relaunch with? Okay, I think it's a great question. If you're a note taker, I want you to write these things down. I'm gonna give you five things we are gonna relaunch with here at Springdale. Many of those same things apply to moving towards the fall at Pinnacle as well. Number one is this. We're gonna relaunch with a renewed commitment to who we are. A renewed commitment to who we are. You may be new. You say, well, who are we? I appreciate you asking and helping me with the sermon today. We're recommitting to some old things from our history as a church. When God put all this on my heart about Relaunch Springdale a few months ago, I called my dad, who served as pastor here for 32 years, and I said, "Dad, this is what I got going on in my heart." I said, "Talk to me about the best days at Springdale campus. What were those marked by?" And he mentioned a few things, and I've kind of combined it with a few things. And here's what we're recommitting to, these old things together. Number one, we're recommitting to evangelism at the Springdale campus. Recommitting to evangelism at the Springdale campus. We are a reaching church here, Fayetteville and at Pinnacle Hills. We're here to reach Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. If you're new here, you're debating, is this my church? Is it not my church? Let me help you out. If you do not like seeing people saved and baptized, you're going to hate it here. You're going to hate it here, okay? And you might need to go somewhere else. But if you see people coming to faith in Christ, you see two of the next generation being baptized in this service here at Springdale, and your heart warms and you think this is the greatest thing in the history of the world, welcome to Cross Church. And we're glad to have you here, okay? This summer, we're gonna prayer walk the city of Springdale, okay? Now, it gets hot in July, so if you wanna prayer drive that thing, that's fine as well. But we're gonna prayer walk the city of Springdale in an evangelistic effort to say, God, we're gonna do what we can do, but we have to have what you can do. We're gonna recommit to evangelism. Number two, we're gonna recommit to worship. And when I mean worship, I mean the entire worship service. In our greatest days as a church, these worship services have been marked by the manifest presence of God. Amen. Moments where we are moved as a people by the worship of God and by the word of God. That's when we are at our best here at Springdale. That is where we are at our best there at Pinnacle Hills. And you say, well, Nick, how do we get there? You know what matters? How you come to church. It really does. It's the difference between a Good Friday service and an Easter service. Good Friday, mainly believers coming ready to worship Jesus. Easter Sunday, it's a mix of lost people, carnal people, saved people, barely saved people. You know what I'm saying? All kinds of people. And you know which one we see often the manifest presence of God fall in? Good Friday. It matters. I want you to come to church ready to worship, okay? Third thing is next gen. When we say next gen or next generation ministries, we're talking about preschool, students, young adults, children, college, that kind of stuff. When we are at our best here at Springdale and at Pinnacle Hills, when we're at our best, we are emphasized winning in preschool, children, and student ministry. And here's what, I'll go even a level deeper. Our trend that we are seeing right now at all three campuses is when our student ministries are humming, the entire church feels the impact of that. And so I wanna praise God for Bryant, Billy, and Paige here at Springdale, for Micah and Kendall and Mason up at Pinnacle Hills who are giving their lives to reach students. You're making a difference. So hear me loud and clear. We're a family church. A family church. Let it be loud and clear throughout Northwest Arkansas. You want to have your kids be in a safe environment where they're going to be challenged to follow Jesus. Cross Church is the place to do that. Amen. And we will continue to invest in that as well. Pinnacle Hills, that's exactly who you are as well. Number two, we're going to relaunch with a church plant mindset. We're going to relaunch with a church plant mindset. Some of you have been a part of planting a church before, maybe here, maybe somewhere else in the country. You think differently when you're in a church plant versus a mega church. Oftentimes people pull into a mega church and they expect the room to be full and they expect every need to be taken care of. In a church plant, every conversation in the community is an opportunity to invite someone to church. So we're going into church plant mode. There's an aggressiveness. There's a passion to grow. There's a passion to reach people. There's a sense of worry that if I don't show up, who's going to show up? If I don't give and tithe, who's going to tithe? If I don't serve, who's going to serve? That's how a church plant thinks versus a mega church. And so I say it loud and clear, down with the mega church mindset, up with a church plant mindset at both of these campuses as well as Fayetteville. Our volunteer team is called the Dream Team. And here's what I'm gonna tell you, and I'm gonna lead you towards this here in a moment. I'm asking hundreds of you to join this Dream Team at Springdale and at Pinnacle Hills for this. Many of you have served at prior times in the church's history, but you're not right now. I'm asking you to come back and help us. Some of you have never served. You just kind of come in, come out. I'm inviting you in. If you're wondering if I'm speaking to you today, I am speaking to you today. Is that clear? All right. We're going to do a few things throughout the summer in this vein. Then listen to me, church. We're going to dominate the month of August. Everybody say dominate. Dominate. Say it with some, okay, that's good. That's not in the notes. It just came out. Okay. Number three, part of that church plant mindset is this. We're going to relaunch with a new First Impressions ministry. This is true at this campus. This is true at the Pinnacle Hills campus. Many of you in these two rooms, you say, well, Nick, I'm already on the First Impressions team. First Impressions just mean it's the first impression that a guest has when somebody walks into the church. And so if you're already on this team, I want to encourage you, stay on the team. We need you in the future. We're just going to be adding a lot more people to your team. And we're going to focus on welcoming people from the parking lots to the worship center. All right? I think it's already a friendly environment both here and at Pinnacle Hills, but we're gonna crank the warmth up, okay, in many, many ways. It takes many of us to do this. In fact, it'll take hundreds more for us to do this in the way that we need to do this. Can we have a lingo conversation for a second? I'll call this a pastoral privilege about what is acceptable to say at Cross Church and what is not acceptable to say at Cross Church. Is this okay? You with me so far? It is never acceptable to say, as long as I'm pastor for the remainder of my time here, it is not acceptable to say, when somebody asks you, well, what do you do at the church? It is not acceptable to say, well, I'm only a greeter. Not acceptable to say any longer. What is acceptable to say is, you know what? I play a small role in a very large plan to provide the most welcoming, accepting, loving, Jesus, warmth kind of place that people have ever experienced. And I do my little part in the parking lot or in the lobby or at the kids' check-in or in the worship center, or I'm ushering, helping people find a seat. I do all that I can because I know I am the first gospel presentation that somebody sees and hears and feels before they ever get to the preacher. That's acceptable to say. I'm a small part of a massive thing. And Pinnacle Hills campus, I'm calling you to this as well. We need to recapture the early days of the church plant mindset, first impressions, dominating kind of church, and it's gonna be an incredible, incredible thing together. Now, either campus, whichever one you walked into today, when you walked in, somebody handed you a card. And here's what I'm asking you to do. This is the goal of today. I'm asking 500 new people at Cross Church Springdale, and 500 new people at Pinnacle Hills to join us on the Dream Team. That's part of Relaunch Springdale that we will start to launch right now as we move towards the fall. And when the fall comes and the month of August hits, what are we gonna do? We're going to dominate a few. You picked it up, that's good. And so I'm asking 500 of you here, 500 of you there to join us in the journey. There's several options of how you can jump on the team. And what a perfect, perfect, perfect time to join what God is doing right here, okay? Here's a fourth thing. We'll start to move towards closure here. We're gonna relaunch at both campuses with English and Espanol closer than ever. Here's the great thing about Pinnacle Hills, your Espanol ministry, and Springdale, your Espanol ministry. Both of these ministries are growing. Isn't that great news? What an incredible thing that is. And I would just say this, they need to keep growing if we are going to reach our community. We're not here just to reach white people. We're here to reach every color under the sun who resides in Northwest Arkansas. And the dominant population here is our Hispanic population that we are continuing to try to do more and more and more to reach. Incredible thing. Every single week, I want to encourage you at Springdale campus. I shouldn't say this, but I'm going to, okay? I'm going to encourage you to skip the first 10 minutes of your small group. It's blasphemy, isn't it? But I'm going to encourage you at some point this summer to skip the first 10 minutes, and I'm going to ask you to stand at the back, and I want you to watch our Spanish-speaking brothers and sisters worship the Lord. 350 to 400 of them gather every single Sunday here at Springdale. On Easter Sunday, 700 Spanish speakers were right here at Springdale. Isn't that awesome? Can I blow your mind? At all three campuses on Easter, we baptized 51 people. Of those who were Spanish speaking, 37 of the 51. Come on, that's worthy of some praise to God. One of my favorite things to do is to walk into Wednesday night where I pick up my kids from their different activities at Springdale campus over there. And it's a beautiful collision of diversity. English and Spanish being spoken, Spanish and English congregations high-fiving, hugging one another. It is a picture of heaven, and we are gonna look more and more and more like heaven. And I'm asking you here, join me in the journey, okay? Finally, and I think this may be the most important thing that we could do to relaunch, both here and at Pinnacle Hills. We're gonna relaunch with a desperation for God to move. We're gonna relaunch with a desperation for God to move. As we kick off the fall semester here, we're gonna be doing a series of sermons where we're looking through the Bible and we're looking at examples of people who were desperate for God to move. We come up with a really creative sermon series title. It's called Desperate for God to Move. Okay? That's why I'm the pastor, guys. Those kind of big decisions like that, all right? Springdale, I'm calling us back to a desperation for God to move. Pinnacle Hills, I'm calling us back for a desperation for God to move. 153 years ago, 13 people, 7 women and 6 men, started a place, and I can imagine that first Sunday, they're thinking to themselves, wow, is anybody else gonna come? And they just began to meet together, and they just began to meet with God. And here we are all these years later at Pinnacle Hills and at Springdale, and I'm calling us to come back to a place where we show up to church desperate for God to move. Literally, we don't want to miss a Sunday because we are so aware that the touch of the Holy Spirit might come down. And we don't want to miss it. Do you realize we need a touch of the Spirit, church? We can only do so much. And one of the greatest things that God could call both of these campuses back to is just a desperation for God to move in our lives. And I'm asking you to join us in this journey. I'm asking you at Springdale campus to join us as we relaunch a campus. We've never really done that. And used an opportunity where God's doing some things, but we're going to relaunch an entire campus to the community, reintroducing ourselves to Springdale and Johnson and Lowell and Fayetteville and Elm Springs. And will you join us? There at Pinnacle Hills, we're gonna relaunch up there with a desperation for God to help us reach into Centerton and Bentonville and Bella Vista and Lowell and everywhere, Pea Ridge, everywhere around the Pinnacle Hills campus. God can do some things that we can't do. We've talked about that in this series. God can do things that you and I can't do. It's time for us to cross over. Do you sense it? It's just time. God's done so much in our past. I love seeing the faces that I get to look at right now. So many of you have been a part of our past, and we are here today in 2024 because of your faith in the past. I think of men who've graduated to heaven. Ted Schneider, Stan Bedford, Anna Mary Lehman, and many, many others who paid a price in their generation so the work of God in this church could go forward. And I'm asking for the next Anna Mary Lehman's, Ted Schneider's, Stan Bedford's to rise up here at Springdale and to lead us into the future. I'm asking for the same to take place at Pinnacle Hills, that the great men and women of God who have led us up to this point in our 20 plus year history, that you would say, you know what? God's calling me to pick up the mantle right now and me to pick up the torch and to move forward. So will you do that today? How many of you is God calling back to a place of remembrance? How many of you is God calling to faith instead of fear? How many of you, God is calling to say, you know what? We've always been kind of fringe, but God's calling us to get into the game. whatever it is that God's doing, would you do that today? Some of you are here and you don't know Christ, and in all reality, here's the message of God for your life. It's time to cross over the line of faith today. You maybe heard the gospel. You know that it's time for you to receive Christ. You know that this is what God is asking you to do, and yet you've been hesitant, you've been reluctant. Let today be the day that Jesus Christ saves you and changes your life. He can do it. And for you, it's time to cross over the line of faith for the very first time. I want us to bow our head and close our eyes. At both of these campuses, our staff is going to make their way to the front of each aisle. Today, if God is moving in your heart, maybe it's just with the desperation for God to move. I want to call people just to the altar, just to say, God, we're desperate for you to move in our church. We're desperate for you to move in our lives. What would God see if he looked down upon Cross Church Springdale and upon Pinnacle Hills today? What would he see? Would he see a congregation of people crying out to him saying, God, we gotta have you. We gotta have your move. We gotta have your touch. Or would he see a congregation of self-sufficiency? What a great word for us today. I'm gonna call some of you just to the altar just to say, God, we're desperate for you today. There are others of you who you're desperate for God to move in your life in some other way, and you need prayer. Here, we're going to have people right near the stage. We'll also have them back by the bleachers. You see some of our pastors standing right there. If you need prayer about something in your life, we'd love to pray for you. Last but not least, if you need to come to faith in Christ today, the men and women of our staff are here. We'd love to lead you to faith in Christ today. All you got to say, walk up and say, I need to give my life to Jesus today. They'll know exactly what they need to do, okay? Lord Jesus, we enter into a new phase of desperation right now before you. We pray that you would do some things that only you can do. We trust you by faith to do that right now. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, amen.